Good morning, class. Glad to have all of you present today. You're looking good. We're blessed today to have a lifetime friend of mine, brother Russ Adair, is going to be singing for us this morning. And also at the end, we're going to have another song by Carroll, Roberson. It's going to bless your heart today. But I want to talk to you a minute. Many of our class members are actually homebound because of sickness. We want to pray for them today. We want to remember our brother Stout that goes to our church also. He's having problems. Brother Stout needs a miracle in his life. To begin with, though, I want to thank Brother Ron House and Brother Marshall Rogers for teaching for the last couple of weeks. And I want to encourage you to stay in today and listen to all of the lesson, because it's talking about us living by faith. And living by faith, of course, is our faith in God, living and trusting God. And we need that more than ever in this time of our lives. The teaching of Brother Ron and Brother Marshall received a lot of views, so a lot of you watched it and got blessed. I'm sure you got blessed for their teaching, and I hope so today. I want to go to the Lord in prayer again, and remember me also in this prayer for the teaching today, that will bring life to you, and out of what we studied, that God would use it for His glory. We count it a privilege to do this, and I'm sorry about being a little bit late today, but we had circumstances for that, cause it to be that way. But just hope you enjoy the lesson, and God bless you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for all you've done for us, Lord. We ask you to touch those that are sick. We're going to call, Lord, some of their names. We remember Brother and Sister Ruby Smith, Brother Ron House, and Sister Mildred, Lord. We ask you to touch his body and hers today. We also ask you to touch Jean Silva's body and Sister Kivett today, God. Help them and increase them, Lord, today. Richard Hare, God, we ask you to move on him today in his life. We give you honor for that you're doing today, and every class member that comes to our church. We ask you to touch Sister Anstine Hall and her daughter, God, today in their lives also. We ask you also, Lord, to help us in this teaching of this lesson. Let it be a blessing to those that are listening, and life, oh God, to bring life to them. And we give you honor and glory for that. Thanks for the supernatural move of your Spirit upon your people, God, and this day to sustain them, Lord, in this time of trouble. Encourage them, God, and we'll give you honor. Let them look unto you, Lord, and not unto man, for the needs that they have in their lives, God. And Father, we just thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Do you feel there's no hope in your situation? Do you think that God's love can reach you there? I found hope at the heart of my darkness. Light broke through, and the answer was clear. There is hope, there is healing for your pain and your fear. There is hope, let faith arise from your despair. There is hope in Jesus Messiah. Cast your cares at His feet and leave them there. Do you doubt you will ever find freedom? Does it seem there is no escape for you? I found the way through the door of salvation. All things past and all things now are new.
Okay, I want to do a little introduction on the lesson this morning. The title of the lesson is Live by Faith, and it's taken out of Galatians, the third chapter, verses 1 through 22. Now, I understand that some of your literature in your book, if you have it and you're going by, all of the text is not in your book that I'm going to be using. However, there's only about three or four verses, I think, that's not in your lesson book. And I think it's verses 15, 16, and 17 that I'm going to be ministering on. It's not there. But follow me in this. Today it says, Christians are called to live by faith in Christ Jesus. And our golden text is that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the Word of God says that the just shall live by faith. That's in Galatians 3 and 11. That's our golden text today. We're going to cover and talk about that a little bit later on. And truly today, we're learning to live by faith. In Galatians chapters 1 and 2, Paul, we're not going to cover that. I'm just mentioning this to you. Paul exposes the false teachers who were in Galatia and defends his position not only as a minister but as an apostle when he was dealing with these people and trying to encourage the church in Galatia. So in chapter 3 today is the lesson, which is our text today. His task was to expose the fallacies. Now, fallacies means the deceptive methods in presenting false teachings. It said the fallacies of their heresy, and heresy is an opinion or doctrine or practice contrary to the truth, which is God's word, but it's generally accepted. What we accept is our belief and our standards. You hear false teachings. Have you ever heard, let me give you an example. Have you ever, you know what the Bible has to say about something, and all of a sudden you're hearing somebody teach something that is contrary to the Word of God. That should perk your ears up to resist that, not even take time to even listen to it. And if you hear someone that has received that, then if you know the Word of God, you're able to help them and correct that. So in chapter 3 here also, Paul discusses the manner in which the Galatian believers have been deceived in believing the false doctrine. We're going to be talking about the manner in which they received this false doctrine. It's very easy to do that. Paul realized here that merely debating the doctrine in writings or on paper wasn't sufficient by itself. So what he had to do was this. What had happened, the believers had been damaged by this. There was damage done among the believers because of this false doctrine. The heresy had had an effect in the lives of those believers. That's what false doctrine does, that it has an adverse effect in your life if you believe false doctrine. I remember I was in a church in Bennettsville, South Carolina one time, and 98% of the doctrine the message he was preaching was truth. But there's 2% of what he had to say. If you believe that, you'd go to hell. If you live by that 2% that he's talked about and ministered as truth, you'd miss out. God would not accept you if that was got into your spirit and you lived that false doctrine. So we have to be really careful. False teaching can destroy families, it can ruin lives, and split churches. The heresy taught here, though, led the people in Galatia to believe that they must work their way to heaven. How many religions today teach you that? That you have to work your way to heaven, or work your way to eternal life, or work your way to somewhere. Even in Buddhism, you have to take so many journeys before you ever get to where you're going in the spirit world. And then in some of the religions, you've got to suffer. I saw a man one time that punished himself. He had beat his head on the steps in front of this temple so bad his head was real bloodied all over the top of his head. And he stuck newspapers on top of his head and set it on fire, punishing himself because he didn't feel worthy. I know in Mexico, there's a group of Mexicans that believe that in a certain times of year that they punish themselves, and they'll take like a whip, like the cat of nine tails that Jesus got whipped with, and actually beat themselves in their back on a march to and punish themselves for that. You know, Jesus Christ set us free from any bondage. Even under the law of Moses, you're set free from the penalties of the law because you're saved by grace and you live by faith. That doesn't mean that you're perfect. But we're going to get into all of that. And here Paul had a twofold task with the Galatians. Number one, he had to expose the heresy to them, what it was. And then he had to convince the Galatians that they must turn again to the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Paul states his position early on and clearly and effectively when he began to talk to them. He tells them what they should believe, reminds them of what they should believe, then he urges them to believe it. Okay, part one of our lesson this morning is to receive the Spirit by faith. Everything we do when it comes to God is by faith. We have received the Word of God by faith and have received that that God had done that to us by faith. Now, the Galatians had done something different. And I found in times past that many Pentecostal movements in the past had legalism in the sense of what's going on here. They were, the law was under was the old covenant, and they had to be do rituals or do various things to maintain righteousness. But when Jesus Christ came, we're going to find out the promise to Abraham was Christ himself, to the followers or believers of Abraham's heritage that followed his teachings. But Christ was the promised seed. And we're going to find out also that in him we have a new covenant, and that new covenant is grace. And Jesus made a statement. I want to cover this completely. Jesus made a statement in his teachings that he did not come to do away with the law. He came to fulfill the law. And how he came to fulfill the law was that he was to create in us a new spirit that could be obedient to the law just by character and way of life. You don't have to make a decision to keep the laws of concerning like lying, stealing, adultery. You don't have to, you don't even consider those things if you're a Christian, because your nature has changed. Doesn't mean temptations are not there, but you don't walk that way, because walking in Christ, it's a new walk, it's a new life. And so we live by faith. We have to accept the doctrine of the crucifixion of the cross and the resurrection of Christ and what he did for us, and not change our faith in what the cross did for you and I. The cross put us in right standing with God, and in Christ Jesus we stand before God. Therefore, we don't stand before God in ourselves. We stand before him in Christ Jesus, and the blood of Christ has cleansed us as clean as we'll ever get. But there is a progressive walk every day that we have to sanctify ourselves daily. But it does not mean that we go through rituals. Like I do remember a long time ago, they had to wear the right kind of clothing. And I believe in modesty. I believe in apparel to be pure. I don't believe that, and you know what I'm talking about. We don't want to get into legalism. And not even trying to do that today, because we don't want to go back into what we're trying to teach that Paul was doing with the Galatians, wanting to get you to learn how to walk by faith, because it's in what Christ did and not what you did. You can't earn salvation. Christ freely gave salvation to us, and we accept that by faith. However, I do know that we have to work at that, because the passage of Scripture said for us to put on the armor of God daily, and if we really know what the armor is, that's doing something every day of our life. For instance, like the helmet of salvation means that you maintain a saved mind. How do you do that? You don't let things come before your eyes and come into your ears that would pollute your spirit. You watch what you look at. You watch what you read. You study. You understand. You watch and listen what you listen to. You don't walk into areas of temptation. All of those things are involved. But you do that by faith, and God gives you through and by His Spirit power to overcome that. So here Paul began to deal with them in verse 1 here, and he said, "O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you?" So he began this chapter identifying one of the primary marks of false teaching. He said, those who became foolish. Because of the false teaching, they had actually became foolish. Now, foolish is a word, it's a Greek word that literally means without wisdom or thinking. They had done these things without even thinking about it. It also meant that the Galatian believers had acted without clearly considering the results of their actions. How many times have you ever made the wrong decision, even when it comes to the things of God, and it caused you grief? These people here acted without wisdom or spiritual discernment in their lives. Paul identifies the nature of their foolishness with the word bewitched. I don't know if some people are bewitched today, but anything that would take you away from the true doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ is a false spirit, an antichrist spirit. It would bewitch you in that respect. So bewitched means that, in other words, they had been swayed by these false teachers. And as a result, they were acting unreasonably. They were doing things that was not even common sense as far as Christianity is concerned. And they had allowed themselves to be mesmerized. Have you ever seen people that were just caught up with an individual and their personality or their charisma in the ministry? We have many people that have been caught up with false doctrines, and we can go back even to the Jim Jones situation, which was a terrible thing. He was teaching them false doctrine. And undoubtedly, they had started out believing in Jesus Christ, and before it was over with, the end of their disobedience cost them their lives. Now, the essential truth about their actions, that they were disobedient to God. He conveyed this phrase, but the phrase he used here, it let us know that he said that you should not obey the truth. He said, who deceived you that you shouldn't obey the truth? You see, God himself, it says God himself had given the truth. So here these teachers had wooed them away from the truth, but yet Paul was calling the Galatians responsible for their actions. They were responsible for doing that. They should have known better. You know, sometimes we know better, but it happens anyway, and it comes from our disobedience. There's no excuse for disobedience. If you know the truth of the Word of God, there's no reason for you to be disobedient. They had failed to preserve the truth of the gospel in their lives. I find true today that most people, they fail to know the truth because they don't read the truth. They don't study the Word of God. They don't, and they're open to whatever's told them. If you don't know the Word of God for yourself, then you just follow what you're being told. But Christians today need to guard against the charisma of false teachers. Nothing relieves us from the responsibility to remain obedient to God. You're held accountable for that. You're supposed to be obedient. We're not to be taken in by a smooth delivery. You know, sometimes people can make it sound so good, it's almost perfect. Mm-hmm. It's like I said, this man, 90% of what he said, 98% of what he said was truth, but the other 2%... would cause you spiritual death. And so regardless of circumstances, the verdict upon anyone who is disobedient to the truth of the gospel is foolish. You're foolish to get away from the truth of the gospel because it'll cost you your eternal life if you do that. We're to guard ourselves against teachers of doctrine that do not reflect the biblical message of Christ. Now in verses 2 and 5, we're going to be talking about the law and flesh and faith and spirit. Said in the verse 2, it said, "This only would I learn of you, received ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith?" In other words, he said, did you get saved because you were obedient to the law, or did you get saved by faith? He said, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by the flesh? Does the things that you do in the flesh make you perfect before God? No. It doesn't do that. So have you suffered so many things in vain? If it be yet in vain, he therefore that ministered to you in this, to you the Spirit, and worketh miracles among you, doth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Now Paul identified the basic problem here of the Galatians, the problem they had. They had moved from a life commitment to faith, a life committed to faith, and the Spirit into a life of bondage to the law and the works of the flesh. So in dealing with this problem, he asked them a series of questions to probe or to investigate the nature of their current walk, or to reveal it with Christ. So how are they walking with Christ now? So verse 2 is the basic question from which all other questions come. Paul asked, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing with faith. If their receiving of the Spirit had been by works, they would have earned it through their keeping of the law. You can't earn salvation, but it was by faith. They had received him in spite of their failure to keep the law, and only because of their faith and trust in Christ. They were not able to keep the law, because one of the problems they had was this. You remember in the old covenant, they would offer sacrifices for their sins and their atonement. Now, we take it they came once a year. That was a corporate repentance. But on an individual basis, they could offer, even as if they were poor, even turtle doves for their sins. And you know, when Jesus, Mary and Joseph went to with Jesus to the temple, they had turtle doves with them because they were poor people. But they were rich with Christ, but poor in flesh. But they had to continuously offer sacrifices because they were continuously sinning against the law. Their nature had not been changed. Jesus said he came to fulfill the law through and by, change, and this is what he did. He changed our nature. He changed our desire. We don't want to sin. We don't want to be disobedient to the law because our nature has changed. We have a new conscience. Our conscience has been saved. Therefore, we have the, what we call it, is condemnation comes if we do something wrong. But if we walk in the Spirit, there is no condemnation there when we're walking in the Spirit. But we walk in the flesh, we have condemnation. What does condemnation mean? It means that we are separated from God. And we know that until we make that right. And we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, that will intercede for us if we are openly repentant. And we don't lose any space with God. He loves us, and that's where grace comes in. Now, under the law, you would have been put to death for transgressing. But under grace, you... God himself receives what Jesus Christ did at the cross. Therefore, you can walk continuously toward God as long as you have a repentant heart. And when condemnation comes to you for walking in the flesh. Now, here he said this, works of the law clearly identifies the nature of the heresy here that they were believing. I'm getting my notes together here just for a second. They followed religious and traditional observances in an effort to keep the commands of the law. And they were endeavoring to find favor with God based on their ability to keep the commandments. Look, there's no more favor that you need with God because he loved you. You didn't come into the kingdom of God because you wanted to. He drew you into the kingdom of God. It's by his Spirit he drew you, and you responded by faith and received it. So hearing of faith under the hand identifies the nature of the gospel which Paul preached. The message the Galatians believed when they first became Christians was the message that Paul preached. They heard the message of faith and they received it. So salvation is freely given. It's not earned. Faith opened the door of their heart to receive God's salvation and to apply it in their life. So Paul knew their initial experience had been genuine, and he appealed to it. So now here the Galatian Christians had risked much and suffered by becoming followers of Christ. Because in their day, the Romans ruled, and they ruled with hardness. And if you remember, Paul was even a man that in the Roman army that was taking Christians to the slaughter, where they would be thrown to the lion's den and places like that, to the arenas. Because of their faith. So the Christians were facing persecution back then that we don't face in America yet. But we're beginning to see the pangs of the ends of time through sufferings. Mm-hmm. And we ourselves need to hold fast to our faith and not let false doctrine enter in, because when persecution comes, you won't stand. You won't be able to hold on because you're not walking in truth. You're not walking in faith in God and his ability for what he can do for you. Even with this virus and stuff that's going on right now, people are walking around in fear. I see it everywhere I go. They're scared they're going to catch this thing and die. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you what, the blood of Jesus Christ, I'm not stupid now, don't get me wrong. We're not dealing with that and being stupid here today. Because I believe, though, there's a hedge of protection about me. And if I don't, I tell people all the time, God's grace is good, and God's grace is sufficient, and His power is almighty. But now I don't go play in the traffic and tempt God. So this is what I'm saying to you today and this thing that's going on, though. But I don't walk around in fear. I don't do that because God is in control of my life, because I've allowed Him to do that. But I walk by faith in what His Word says. He says if I keep His commandments and His statutes and be obedient to Him, in other words, if I be a Christian like I'm supposed to be, doing what I know to do, righteous in Him, then He would not allow any or put any of the diseases of this heathen land upon me. Folks, I'm telling you, God, we're in God's hand. He's protecting us. You got to believe that. So we walk in faith. It says, these people had witnessed miracles, and which were the product of faith, not the law. Today we witness miracles. Those are by faith. Those things come by faith. Faith will pull the supernatural things of God out of heaven into the faith takes the supernatural things of God and brings them into the natural realm to where you witness and have it. So it's faith. It brings the impossible to reality. Okay, the next major part of the lesson is to reject the reliance on the law. Galatians 3:10-14. So we're dealing with the curse of the law. He said in verse 10, for as many as are the works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. So Paul poses the problem, the law's demand for perfection. For those that live by the law, if you lived it perfectly, you had to live it perfect. You couldn't deviate at all. You remember the guy that picked up a stick on Sunday and they killed him? Boy, that'd be tough. Man. All of us would be guilty of all of us would be guilty of committing sin on the Sabbath today. But grace covers us in those some areas there. I believe we need to respect today. But anyway, no one except Christ has been able to do this. So with this in mind, because Christ was obedient to the, you got to hear this, when He was on this earth, He obeyed the law. Even though He was going to be the deliverer for you and I, to keep Him had to be under the bondage of the law, the penalty of the law. He was going to set us free from that. He Himself did that. He was took our place in being obedient to the law before the cross. But the work of the cross set us free from the bondage of the penalty of the law. So Paul proceeds to apply the verdict that rests on everyone. So since none of us have to be able to keep every part of the law perfect, we are cursed. Our curse comes from the Greek word, which means to set forth in the judgment of God. Paul quotes in Deuteronomy 27:26, which declares it, that a curse falls on everyone who is not able to keep all of the law. And highlighting this judgment, Paul is noting that keeping the law perfect is impossible. But as a result, we're under God's judgment for what we have not kept, no matter how small the offense may have been. With this in mind, Paul proceeds to explain what can be done with the curse. The next part of the lesson is justification by faith. Now, I've always talked about justification as this. Being justified means that it's just as if I had never sinned. That's the position or the place I have with God now. Jesus Christ put me back and justified me, made me justified before God. That's what justification is. Paul in the 11th verse says, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. See, the law doesn't justify you, because you under the law it said it's evident, for the just shall live by faith. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. In other words, if you commit break a law, a godly law or man's law, you pay the penalty of breaking that law. But under the grace of God, through faith, we have an advocate with the Father, that if I do transgress, I have an advocate, which is Christ, and if I repent and ask forgiveness, then I'm He justifies me before God again, and I can continue to walk in grace before God. That's where grace is at. Now, under the law, we would pay the penalty of that, the curse of that. Now, the only answer for the curse brought on by disobedience is faith in Christ. So to make this point, Paul declared that the obvious conclusion of our inability to keep the law perfect, in other words, we are not justified by God through the law, because we can't keep the law perfect. We can't do that. Paul shifts from the problem of judgment to the solution of faith. He declares the answer, the just shall live by faith. You're justified if you live by faith in God. He's quoting from Habakkuk 2 for the fact that he does not preface a quotation with the word such as it is written, indicates that quotation was probably familiar to the Galatians. In other words, they knew it. He didn't have to say this is in the word or this is in scripture. He just said the just shall live by faith because they were familiar with that already. It is a truth they should have known and maintained it anyway. So the principle Paul quotes shows the vital connection between righteousness and faith. One abides with the other. They are inseparable. If you have faith, you can live righteous. And if you live righteous, you will do it by faith. So, however, righteousness is also the fruit of the life of faith. It's the gift from God. God allows you to do that through and by He changed your spirit. Remember I told you, He changes your spirit. So the gift of God is this, He made you a new person. You're a person that don't want to sin against God if you're a Christian. There's some highlights here in verse 12. It said the division between the law and faith was this, no one can receive salvation by doing the works of the law. And we cannot depend on the works and claim to live by faith. In other words, you can't earn your way. The person dependent on the works of the law is not made righteous by the law. Dependence of the law brings the curse of God. However, the life of faith brings righteousness. In the next part it says, redemption from the curse. Now Christ, according to verse 13, it says, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we may receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I'm a Gentile. I was not born Jew. But I can come through Jesus Christ and obtain the promises of God of Abraham, which is the Jewish promises, the promises of God in the Word to the Jewish people. Because I've been adopted into the kingdom of God, and the adoption I have here is of the bloodline of Christ. You hear what I'm saying? I'm not some outsider now. I've been adopted into the kingdom of God, and I've become of the bloodline of Christ. Therefore, I'm living in Christ, redeemed from the curse of the law through and by the work that He had done on the cross. It said Paul, in verse 13, presents the answer to the curse of the law, Christ's work on Calvary. Satisfied the demand of the law placed on sinful people. Christ was able to redeem us by being made a curse for us. His work was a substitution. I can't even pronounce that. It was a work of substitution. He took the curse upon himself. So what he did is he took the punishment of sin and he died on the cross in my place. Actually, he died. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Okay. If I'm redeemed from the wages of sin and I never die, you understand the principle of that? Redeemed from the curse of the law was death. When I've been redeemed from the curse of the law, I have life. I'll never die. Jesus died in my place. He took the punishment of my sins on the cross. And by me accepting that by faith, I'll live forever with Him. I'll live forever. I'll never die. I told a man one time, a brother in Haiti, that I was living eternally now because the day I was born again in Christ Jesus began my eternal life. And I'm never going to die. I'll transition from absent from this body present with the Lord, but I'll never die because of my faith in Christ and believing and walking by faith. You have that promise yourself. Jesus, having borne the burden of the curse of sin, made our redemption possible. Redeemed comes from a Greek term that's frequently used for the purchase of slaves. We were a slave to sin. Christ redeemed us from sin. Therefore, He paid the price for us. We're free. He said, whom I set free is free indeed from the curse of the law. So Christ purchased us out of the bondage of sin, and he removed us from the curse of God's judgment. He bore our punishment by taking it on himself. So having given the solution to the curse of sin, Paul showed the blessing the believer receives as a result. Here he describes the blessing with two phrases: the blessing of Abraham and the promise of the Spirit. Both of these were received through faith in Christ. They're related but emphasize different aspects of Christian new life in Christ. The blessing of Abraham refers to having righteousness credited to us through faith in God. Now the promises of the Spirit emphasize the new life we receive through the power of the Spirit once we trust in Christ. Faith in Christ and his work brings us the blessings of justification and new life. So we have the power through and by the Spirit of God in us to maintain this walk of faith. The Spirit of God in us will help us do that. Therefore, we have the blessings of justification with this new life. Now we're going to deal with the inheritance by promise. This passage of Scripture talks for in the inheritance to be of the law. In verse 18, it is no more a promise, but God gave it to Abraham by promise. So Paul confirms that the inheritance of Abraham did not come by works. Abraham received this truly by faith, but the promise of the law was in existence then, but Abraham received the promises of God by faith. Mm-hmm. It was not the law that he received the promises in. So the inheritance is, the promises came, I think it was about 300 years or so later, 300 or 400 years later, that the promises of Abraham came to effect when Christ came and offered himself. So here we have now the law and the mediator. Now, I've said that a while ago. Wherefore then serveth the law? It is added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and is ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. So after removing the law as a source of salvation, because before, if you were obedient to the law and you offered a blood sacrifice, you had salvation. But Abraham received his promises even though the law was in effect before the law was in effect. You see, the law was not in effect when Abraham. It came later. Then he received the promises by faith. So Paul tells the Galatians what the purpose of the law really was. It was given because of the transgressions of men and women. It was to identify the transgressions and what they were so they would know they were sinning. So that's what the law was about. Then we go on to righteousness by faith. Is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid, for if there had been a law given which could have given life, very righteousness should have been by the law. Nor does the law, if the law, promises of God through the law could have given salvation, then it would have been by the law. But it wasn't. It said, but the Scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Christ, Jesus Christ, might be given to them that believe. You've got to believe in Jesus Christ to have life, eternal life, and the faith that it takes for us to continue to walk daily is in Christ Jesus and the work that he did. Many people today think they can work their way to heaven, and their heart's not set on earning favor with God. It's set on earning favor with God by being obedient to the tradition and rules. But little do they realize that God's standard is perfection, a standard they cannot reach through and by being obedient to the law. Perfection only comes through and by Jesus Christ and accepting him by faith. Other people are more standard of God's word, feeling that they deserve heaven because they once prayed the sinner's prayer. They say the sinner's prayer, but they live any way they want to. And they expect God's going to just usher them right on to heaven. That's not going to happen, because the only way that we can gain freedom from the power of the lure of sin and favor and have favor with a perfect God and an entrance to heaven is strictly our faith in Christ, and because he's the one that's perfect. It's him. If Christ is in us and we're in him, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Even nothing can separate you from the love of God, because he died for sinful man. God still loves even the sinner. He hates it. It worries him. He came and died because of sinners. But He himself also has made the place for us to live a perfect life in Christ Jesus. Now, we can't live that perfect life in ourselves, but we don't have to be obedient to traditions of man. We have to be obedient to the Word of God. So we can live perfect in the Word of God in Christ Jesus, through and by the Spirit of God and the Holy Ghost that He's given us the power to overcome sin and to live that life. I'm not going to tell you that you won't do something that sometimes you just get into yourself, into the flesh realm, because the Word of God talks about that. When I said it a while ago in Romans 8, it said, therefore there is no more condemnation than to walk in the Spirit, not in the flesh. So we're commanded to walk in the Spirit, so we won't have condemnation. So we won't have the guilt. That's what condemnation is. Now, I want to talk about the golden text today a little bit, and I'm going to finish that. I'm going to retract a little bit of something I was talking about. I don't know if I used the right word a while ago when I was talking about nothing worries God. I used the wrong word there. When it comes to our action, it disappoints Him. Maybe that's what I need to say. It gets disappointed, because I saw in the scripture one time when the children of Israel, when it comes to offering their children to the god Molech, if you read that passage of scripture and look that up, it said that God Himself said this, it never entered His mind that they would do that. So sometimes we do surprise God by our actions. He's given us a free will to do things, but sometimes he gets disappointed in our actions and what we do, because He set a way for us to walk, and it's by faith. He's even given us a pattern to go by, which is Jesus Christ. If we have the Spirit of God in us, we'll have the fruits of the Spirit in us, the gifts of the Spirit in us, and the Holy Spirit in us will guide us and direct us. He's a teacher. He will bring life to us in that. I want to talk to you about the golden text a little bit. It said that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. So God's looking for a people who trust Him completely. He is the Creator, and we are the created. And we must depend entirely on Him for salvation. Our trust and belief in His ability to see us as we are, and our willingness and to yield to His authority, will set us free from the law of personal piety. In other words, we won't think more of ourselves than we are, because we know we've got to depend on Him. The Bible even teaches this. If you think highly of yourself, you're subject to a fall. You're right before a fall. So we don't need to be lifted up in our self-righteousness, because it's in Him that we live. Said we have seen people who have lived as unbelievers, yet when they died, the preacher told of their good deeds to others and their integrity. All their good deeds and honest dealings cannot substitute the faith for faith in Christ. You cannot work yourself into heaven. God's people will show their faith by honoring God and worshiping together while living the life of faith. Mm-hmm. Living by faith embodies a daily, personal time of Bible reading and prayer. And faith comes from reading the Bible and learning of God's power over all the universe. Faith gives us, you got to hear this, the confidence to enter the throne room of God through prayer and intercede for others and ourselves. There is no greater lifestyle than the life of faith. Knowing that God is our Heavenly Father and that He loves us creates the best future possible, which is eternal life in heaven with Him to rule and reign forever. I certainly don't want to go to the opposite place. So I want to live by faith, being obedient to the Word of God. And if I do feel like I've done something wrong, I ask Him to forgive me and get to keep the book clean, keep the slate clean. Don't let anything. I believe this. Now, really, if you truly get saved, I believe you're mm-hmm. as secure in your salvation as you'll ever be as long as you walk by faith. But I've always said this, that sin has always separated man from God. So any unrepentant sin could keep you out of heaven, according to the Word of God. But I believe you can stay saved. I don't believe nothing can take you out of the hand of God if you don't walk away yourself. You understand? So live by faith, and I encourage you to do that. Hold fast to your faith. Hold fast to what you believe. And God bless you. Enjoy this next song, and I know you will.
one pair of hands for the mountains, one pair of hands for the sea, one pair of hands made the sun and every bird, every flower, every tree. One pair of hands on the valleys, the ocean, the rivers, and the sand. Those hands are so strong, so when life goes wrong, put your faith into one pair of hands. One pair of hands heal the sick. One pair of hands raise the dead. One pair of hands calm the raging storm. And thousands of people